Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A United Front by Auburn Tempest and Michael Anderle, narrated by Rachel Dulude. Chapter 1.
Who wants to go faster?
As the question echoes over the sound system, I raise my arms and scream. The force of motion is pulling me into Sloane and trying hard to throw us from the car. Adrenaline fuels my anticipation as my heart races at double time. Sloane is on my left, looking dubious. Dionysus is on my right, grinning like a fool. The Greek god lifts his arms to match mine, and the two of us scream at the top of our lungs. The backward motion pulls us with even more force, bumping in rising and sinking waves as we spin in a wild circle. The music blares at us from all directions and shifts from loud rock and roll to a screaming siren. Our speed increases. There's no way to fight the centrifugal force crushing me against Sloane and Dionysus against me. We compress along the vinyl seat as far as we can go, and I laugh as my hair whips all three of us in the face. I try to wave as Kevin takes our picture from behind the platform gate, but we're going so fast the onlookers are a blur in the distance.
Who wants to go faster?
The ride conductor asks again. Dionysus and I scream our approval, and the speed ratchets up another notch. The siren wails louder, and the world spins by at an incredible rate. My cheek plasters against the sleeve of Sloane's shirt, and I'm thankful for the wide span of muscle holding my head steady. It's amazing. It's been ages since I've had this much fun. Like all great things, eventually, the ride slows. The three of us can gain some distance on the bench seat, and a moment later, we bump to a stop. My cheeks hurt from laughing, and when I see the look on Sloane's face, I laugh even harder.
What? You didn't love that?
The glare he pegs me with is hilarious.
Love being crushed by my insane girlfriend and her equally insane Greek sidekick while being spun like a lab sample into a centrifuge.
I know all Sloane's varying degrees of grouch and grumble. His family repressed the little boy in him so long that he doesn't know how to connect with his id. Dionysus, on the other hand, is all id all the time.
I didn't know black men could get so pale.
He pokes Sloane's cheek.
You're not going to lose your corn dog, are you, Irish?
Sloane throws the two of us a heated look, and when the mechanics of the ride release, he pushes the safety bar off his lap so he can get up and get out.
The two of you aren't nearly as funny as you think you are.
Dylan and Evangeline get out of their car behind us and jog down the slope to walk out together.
Did you like that, Eva?
I don't need to ask. The answer is as plain as the dimples in her cherubic cheeks and the bounce in her blonde curls. Her expression has her lit up like the angel she is. How no one else in the crowd realizes she's ethereal is beyond me.
Goodness, yes, that was so much fun.
Dylan and I are going to race back to the end of the line and do it again. Do you three want to come? I fight my instinct to join them and consider Sloane's lack of enthusiasm. You go ahead. We'll take camera duty from Kevin so he, Callum, and Nikon can have their turn. When you finish, we'll head over to the concert center to claim our spot for the live music. Dylan chuckles.
You're passing up a chance to go on the Polar Express? I never thought I'd see the day. When we were kids, Fee spent all her midway tickets on this one ride. The rest of us would take turns riding with her, then go off to try some of the other rides. Not Fee. She was here for the duration.
I grin. Why mess with perfection?
Clear the platform, please.
Yep, the ride conductor is talking to us. We shuffle toward the exit gate, and Dylan and Evangeline turn to get back in line.
Do you want to come with us, Greek?
Dylan asks. Dionysus grins and nods.
Absolutely. Can I be on the outside? I want to get crushed this time.
I laugh and hang back while Callum, Kevin, and Nikon get ushered in with the next round of riders. Kev jogs over to hand me his phone and turns to follow Callum and Nikon to the car they chose. "Have fun," I call, searching for the best spot to take their picture.
"Are you disappointed to be taking a pass in the next round of fun, Agra?"
Sloan asks.
"If you want to join your brothers, I'm happy to be the one taking pictures."
I shake my head. "Of course not. Today is a celebration of life and love. I'm Team Mackenzie all the way. The fact that you didn't love the absolute best ride of the country fair, the ride that anchors all my happiest childhood memories, doesn't diminish my love for you at all. Seriously, not even a little." He looks at me, his brow arching.
"Are you trying to be funny?"
I sober, and apparently not doing a very good job of it today. "Not even the hint of a smile, eh? Nothing?" Sloan sighs and offers me an apologetic smile.
"Sorry, love. I'm not feeling well, and the high-speed spin didn't do much to help the situation."
"What kind of not feeling well? Is it your stomach? Do you have a headache?"
"A bit of both. I woke up feeling grotty, and things haven't improved since then."
"Woke up? That was hours ago. You should have said something." He waves away my concern and draws a deep breath.
"You've been looking forward to today for weeks. I'll not let a wee stomach bug ruin our day."
A cold shiver races down the length of my spine, and suddenly nothing seems funny anymore. "You don't actually think it's a wee stomach bug, do you? Like a wee blue bug, maybe?" The music grows louder as the ride begins its backward spin. Sloan studiously avoids watching the cars whiz by and presses his fingers against his lips. Turning his back to the action, he swallows.
"Nothing like that, no. But if it's all the same, I think I'll go talk to Dylan and the others in line."
I take a few quick pics of Kev and Nikon crushing Callum and laughing their heads off, then straighten. "Lead the way, hotness. If you need to puke, give me a signal and I'll part the sea like you read about." I've seen him barf blue beetles once and I don't ever want a repeat performance.
"Thank you, Lady Moses. I'm sure things will settle once we join Liam and Katie and sit for the concert."
"Yeah, I'm sure they will. At least, I hope so."
"Fee, over here!"
I follow the rich timbre of my bestie's voice to find Liam stretched out on one of two blankets, taking up a large patch of grass. Katie, his girlfriend of the last 6 months, is spread out beside him, and the two of them are hogging as much space as they can while being glared at by the surrounding concertgoers. Sloan and I pass the assigned seating, climb the concrete steps cutting into the hillside, and make our way across the manicured grass to join them. The Markham Fair is one of Canada's oldest country fairs and has been a yearly event since 1844. There are prizes awarded for livestock, quilting and sewing, baking and preserves, harvested vegetables, and all manner of crafts. As well, there is a tractor pull, the midway, and live bands all weekend. Some of my favorite family memories are of Da and Mam driving us north of the city and bringing us here. They'd take us through a barn or two and lay out a couple of blankets as our home base. They'd listen to the bands while the six of us ran wild through the fair, going on rides and eating midway food until we were ready to puke. Sloan swallows and makes a face.
"Let's not talk about puking if you don't mind.
Yeah, sorry." The stage is set and looks ready to roll. Then there is a large floor section, an upward slope that includes the assigned seating, and general admission seats across a massive grass slope. Sure, the people in assigned seats can see better and have a roof over their heads, but with the sound system, the video screens, and the sun shining on a beautiful October afternoon, grass seats rule. "Hey guys, how's your day going?" I settle on the thick Mexican blanket we cools use for picnics, concerts, and hockey games. "Great spot." Liam is lounging on his back with his hands behind his head and his eyes closed. With the sun warming his face, he looks as content as I've ever seen him.
Was there any doubt? This ain't my first fare.
I grin at the dirty looks the couple next to us throw my way. I see the two of you have been making friends with the neighbors. A sly smile curls across Liam's lips, but he doesn't open his eyes.
First come, first served is the law of the land. I can't help it if people aren't as committed as I am to having a great home base.
Sloane lowers himself to the grass beside me, and I stretch out on the blanket to look up at the sun and soak up some rays myself. Man, what a beautiful day.
They don't get much better in October.
I bet this is Brenny's doing. He knew we were having a day dedicated to him and living life, and he rigged us the best weather of the month.
That wouldn't surprise me in the slightest.
Liam chuckles.
Have you got sunscreen on, girlfriend? I know it's October, but I also know how you fry.
Yes, dear, I chuckle, but he's not wrong to be cautious. With my red hair, blue eyes, and pale Celtic complexion, direct sun hasn't always been my friend. I can't even count how many times I've come home from playing football with the boys or volleyball on the beach and have been fried redder than a boiled lobster. Sloane, however, doesn't have that problem. His mocha brown complexion gets darker and more tanned through the summer, but he doesn't burn. Lucky duck. A shrill whistle pierces the air, and I sit up, searching for whichever one of my brothers is looking for us. I don't see anyone, but hundreds of people are flooding in and taking their seats. It's funny what you get used to over a lifetime. I can pick out the whistle of any member of my clan anywhere in a large crowd, even if I can't see them. Pinching my finger and thumb together, I press it under my tongue and blow. The whistle I release in response matches the tone and volume of the first one. Katie winces and bends her head away from me.
Shit, Fee, I think you just blew my eardrums.
My bad, sorry.
Marco,
Emmett yells somewhere in the distance.
Polo,
I yell back.
Marco,
he yells again a minute or two later. I see him then and raise my hand to wave.
Em, over here.
Once he and Ciara are on their way over, I settle in next to Sloane and check on him.
How are you feeling, hotness? Any better?
Do you mean is my headache any better with your whistling and screeching? No, I'm afraid not.
I wrinkle my nose and offer him a genuine look of apology. Oops. Okay, close your eyes and I promise no more yelling until the concert starts. That should give you a good half hour to rest.
Rest?
Emmett joins us with Ciara.
Nobody rests at the live bands of the fair. This is Brenny's 1 year celebration of life.
It is. I keep my voice down so I don't disturb Sloane. It's hard to believe it's been 1 year without him. It still kind of feels like he's on an undercover assignment and he's going to come home. Liam nods.
I've felt like that more than once. I also think he was too big of a personality to truly die. He'll always be with us. I figure he's here spending the day with us at the fair, waiting for us to start raising many overpriced pints at the concert.
I chuckle. That sounds about right. Liam grins.
There's nothing he loved more than family and having a good time.
I point at the concession stand at the base of the hill.
Then I guess we better get some bevvies so we can get this party started in true, cool style.
I like the way you think, sister.
Emmett straightens and checks the line at the three kiosks down on the concrete pad.
First round is on me.
I shake my head and jump to my feet.
Nope, Brendan is picking up the tab today. I'll come with you and help carry.
Liam jumps up too.
I'll come. Hot dogs, anyone? Since Brenny's buying, we might as well go all out.
The offer of hot dogs gets a yes on all fronts. He nods.
We might as well get some for Dylan, Eva, and the Greeks too. They've been working up an appetite on the Midway rides all afternoon.
Will do.
Do you want me to come, love?
Sloane opens his eyes. I wave that away and check my watch. No, you rest. You still have 20 minutes to feel better before things get started. This is a celebration. I want you to be able to enjoy it with us. Emmett, Liam, and I navigate across the crowded lawn, placing our feet so we don't tromp on anyone's hands or personal belongings. By the time we make it back over to the concrete steps, Dylan, Eva, and the Greeks are funneling toward the gates at the far entrance to the stage area. After whistling, I wave my hand over my head to get their attention.
Are you good to line up, Fee? Emmett asks. I drank too many slushies and need a pit stop.
Liam and I join the tail end of the incredibly long line, and I chuckle. Yeah, go pee. Liam and I will probably still be standing right here when you get back. Liam grins.
True story.
The two of us spend the next couple of minutes catching up on what we've missed in each other's lives and inching forward in a go-nowhere shuffle. So, Da's taking today on his own with your mom, and tomorrow we're headed to Ireland to set up for the big dragon first birthday party on Gran's and Granda's back lawn. Wanna come?
Sure. I can come for a few hours during the day if Nikon or Dionysus can snap me back to the bar before the dinner rush.
I'm sure that can be arranged. Ah, hell! The shield on my back flares to life. I straighten, scanning the crowd for the source of trouble. Cat crap on a Ritz.
What? Liam telegraphs my gaze, searching the crowd. Did you see something? What's wrong?
My tattoo just fired to life and is burning.
Shit, that's never a good sign.
Nope.
Is it like a warm tingle or like a bonfire whooshing on your back?
Closer to door number two. It's strong, but not a DEFCON alarm.
I suppose that's one good thing.
Liam scowls at the thousands of people coming and going.
Maybe it's a drunk and disorderly and nothing guildworthy?
Maybe.
Hey, Jane.
Dionysus gushes as he, Nikon, Eva, and Dylan join us in the line.
We missed you on the spinny ride. How's Irish feeling?
I hold up a finger to pause Dionysus's enthusiasm, as if that's even possible, and take a moment to let the rest of the group into the loop.
Ah, Fee,
Dylan frowns.
Way to bring down the party, baby girl.
I chuff. Don't shoot the messenger.
Fine, what's our plan?
I consider that for a moment and sort things through. Liam, you take the Brenny debit card and stay in line with Nikon. If the world explodes, Greek, flash him and Katie to safety. The rest of you, spread out, and see if we can deal with whatever is building quickly and quietly. My spidey senses are tingling, and I've got a bad feeling building in the pit of my belly.
Maybe you're just gassy,
Dionysus says.
Or hungry. Sometimes you get cranky if you're hungry.
True, but this isn't that. Something's not right.
Do you have any idea what it is?
Nikon asks. Nope. Sorry. Dylan takes Eva's hand in his.
Would you care to take a stroll through 10,000 people and search for something not right?
Eva giggles. I'd be delighted. Have I told you how sexy you are when you're crappy?
No, but I'm all ears.
I groan and shoo them off, deliberately not listening to any more of their convo. If Eva finds Dylan sexy when he's a crank, both of them are incredibly lucky because Dee is usually grumbling about something. Emmett arrives back a moment later.
Hey, guys, glad you found
Liam and Nikon. If you two see Callum and Kev, fill them in. Emmett, you're with Dionysus and me. Emmett blinks and falls in behind us.
Is anybody going to fill me in?
I would if I could, bro. All I know is my shield is flaring and something wicked this way comes.
Oh, is that all?
Chapter 2. As Emmett, Dionysus, and I make our way through the crowd, I text the Team Trouble WhatsApp group and make sure everyone is informed. Next, I call up Sloane's cell and phone him. It rings a few times and goes to message.
You know who I am, so you know what to do.
Hey, Hotness, if you're awake, we've got a situation. If you're not, you might be soon. Hope you're feeling better. I hang up and shrug. Anything? Dionysus shakes his head.
I'm listening to all the conversations, but nothing yet.
All the conversations? You can hear all these people and what they're saying at once?
Of course. Why? Is that weird?
Not if it's a god thing, I guess. He nods.
Then it's a god thing. Oh, and the connection is especially strong for me when people are drinking and having a good time, which most of these folks are.
Emmett grunts.
We would be too if his stupid shield wasn't acting up.
I laugh. It's not like I planned this. I'm rolling with the punches here, same as you.
Yeah, well, we've got about 10 minutes before the warm-up band takes the stage, and we run the risk of impacting everyone's good time. That might work to our advantage.
Dionysus scans the people already seated.
Ruining everyone's good time?
Emmett asks.
No, the concert is starting in 10 minutes. At least then, everyone will sit and give us a chance to see what's going on.
Yeah, that would be good. I point toward the concrete steps leading down into the floor section. There are times when the burning of my shield acts much like the game Hot and Cold. Today is one of those times. It's a slow process, but we're zeroing in on the beacon of bad.
Ticket holders only.
The security guard checking tickets at the gate to the lowest seating section offers me a warm smile. I pull out the general admission stubs stuffed into my back pocket and catch Dionysus's attention.
Of course.
I tilt my head toward the gatekeeper. I'm sure you'll find these are 3 tickets for the front row seating, and all is in order. Dionysus catches my drift and flicks his fingers toward me. The tingle of his magical signature washes over me and eases my tension. The security guard scans the ticket stubs in my hand and nods.
Thank you. Enjoy the concert.
The 3 of us file through the gate and continue our descent toward the empty stage. 3 roadies are finishing, setting guitars in place and doing last-minute sound checks. Tipping my head back to scan the scaffolding above, I search the structure of the roof and catwalks for anything that seems out of place. I swear, when the gods get bored, they sit up on their marble dais, grab the pegs of a giant wheel of chaos, and give it all they've got. It's like a real-life version of Wheel of Fortune, only with more bankrupt spots and, I'm sure, much more laughter. Dionysus barks a laugh, and 2 girls with midriff t-shirts and lots of cleavage eye him up.
Honestly, it gets old after a couple of 100 years. Even gods can mature and evolve. People blame the fates, but that's not fair either.
No, it's not. I step down a few more stairs while I continue to search. I've met those ladies, and they're lovely. Dionysus grins.
They are indeed.
No, it's not the fates we need to worry about. It's the Hecate and Eros kind of gods that cause chaos like this. Or bad apples in the Fae realm like Keldane, Prince of the Unseelie. Or the evil souls who manage to escape their Netherlands prison when the psychotic lover opens a rift during a sacred ritual. Or vampires who hear the blood song of their prey because some psychotic female drugs them in an attempt to take over the empowered crime ring in the city. Wow, it's a wonder magic is even a secret at all. There. I point at a white pouch the size of a sandwich bag, tied to one of the crossbeams on the scaffolding 80 feet above our heads. I don't know how I'm so sure, but when I focus on it, my shield tells me I've hit the jackpot. What do you suppose that is?
I don't know, but there are more than one.
Emmett raises his arm and points in another direction.
Look, there are a bunch of them.
I follow Emmett's gesture and, yeah, now that we know what we're looking for, there's a series of small, white bags tied to the white metal frame of the roof scaffolding. If my shield hadn't drawn me to look for them, I never would have found them.
What do you think they are?
Emmett asks. hex bags, maybe? I say.
To hex who? And why?
The words are still falling from Emmett's tongue when a rush of magic hits us like an EMP pulse. It knocks me, Dionysus, and Emmett staggering back, but doesn't seem to affect anyone around us. My bells thoroughly ring and the world spins for a bit. When the ride comes to a full stop, I look at Emmett and Dionysus to make sure they're all right.
What the fuckity fuck was that?
Dylan snaps, jogging over to join us. My phone rings the next moment. It's Niall Horn's Black and White, a.k.a. Sloane.
Hey, Hotness.
Fee, what just happened?
Didn't you get my message?
No, I don't know. I was sleeping until that surge hit. What's going on?
Not sure. My shield went off and we tracked the hot and tinglies to...
Dionysus snorts beside me.
Yeah, baby, you said hot and tinglies.
I did, but not the good kind. Sorry, dude.
Fiona, please,
Sloane snaps.
Can you focus long enough to tell me what's happening?
Sorry. All I know is that there are a bunch of weird hex bags or something tied to the metal framing of the roof. As for what they do or what that pulse was, I have no idea. Another pulse of raw power hits, and I'm knocked back for a second time. This time, Dionysus grabs my arm to steady himself, and I feel the rush of magic he holds in his cells.
Are you all right, Tarzan?
He's better than that guy,
Dylan says, pointing into the crowd. In the middle of a section of plastic seating, there's a guy doubled over and sprouting fur.
Shit, we've got Mooncalled losing control and shifting in full view of everyone.
Sloane, get Garnet down here.
That's all I get out before I end the call and rush toward the man doubled over and splitting out of his clothes.
Veil of privacy.
It's already too late. People are backing away, eyes wide. And I have no idea where to take him or how to... Shit, he's a grizzly and trapped in a rage of horror. Dionysus, get him out of here before he eats someone. I'll cover you. As Dionysus reaches the grizzly shifter, I throw up a cloud of confusion and release Bruin. Race up the aisle toward the stage. You're the distraction, buddy. Try not to trample anyone.
On it.
Another scream from behind me has me spinning. Well, shit. Two skinheads wearing the marks of the West Village Wizards have their hands up and are throwing off blue and purple sparks like two magical arc welders.
Stand back, puny humans,
one of them shouts.
Behold the power of greatness.
Seriously? That guy's been watching too much sci-fi channel. Dylan and Eva, de-escalate Mr. Greatness.
De-escalate him?
Dylan flashes me a crazy look.
Yeah, sure, Fee, we're on it.
I have faith in you, Dee. I'm already scanning the chaos of the crowd for the next disaster.
Fee, is Bigfoot a thing? Because I've got a huge furry brown guy throwing people like pebbles over here.
I follow Emmett's panicked call, and my mind stalls out.
Holy crap-a-moly, right? That's Bigfoot, right?
All signs point to yes.
Vampires!
Someone screams to my right.
Yep.
Two of Xavier's Seath are standing under one of the hex bags. They're red-eyed and have dropped fangs like the creatures of my nightmares.
Sloane and Nikon, you're on Bigfoot. Emmett, you're on hex bags. Get those things down so we can transport them out of here.
Emmett scowls.
How do you suggest I do that? I left my 100-foot ladder in my other jeans.
I was thinking transfiguration. Be a monkey or a bird or something. You have the most experience with animal forms. Be the solution, Em.
I can't tear my gaze away from Bigfoot. He's incredible. Sure, he's dangling a woman by her ankle 5 feet off the ground, but he's still incredible. While Emmett runs off to figure something out, I zone in on the vampires. If Emmett has the most experience with transfiguration, I have the most experience with vampires. Yay me.
Marcus and Laurent, right?
I approach with my palms up.
You don't want to do this. I know you don't.
You two are part of Xavier's family, and that means something. Higher standards, lots of control. This isn't you. Magic is influencing you. I point up, where a golden lion tamarin and a squirrel monkey are racing along the metal framework above our heads, untying baggies. Go Emmett, and the other monkey person.
You smell good, Lady Druid.
Marcus takes a step forward. Thanks, I try, but seriously, if you two could race out toward the midway, I swear you'll be able to regain control and all will be well.
Or we can finally see what Xavier sees in you. Did you know we can read the imprint of another vampire who fed off you? All we need to do is sink our teeth in and quench our thirst for knowledge and sustenance.
I glance back to ensure my way up the aisle is clear. Bruin is on the stage with a fairy girl with purple wings, so I decide to join him if this comes down to a chase. As flattering as that sounds, I'm going to pass. I gave blood last week, and you know the rules. Once a month at most. Another scream draws my attention to where Dylan and Eva are calming the wizards. As I turn, the curved blade of Eva's scythe lops off someone's head. The detached noggin tumbles through the air, casting bloody spray over the horror-stricken concertgoers.
What the hell?
I said de-escalate, you two! De-escalate! A woman in the splash zone doubles over, hacks and vomits over the blue plastic chair in the next row. I don't blame her. The way my stomach is heaving, I could go for a nice cathartic vomit right now, too. My shield is singeing hot, and I turn to... The vampires took my distraction as a signal to launch. As their movements blur before me, I curse and turn on my heel. Tough as bark. My sneakers smack out a steady rhythm against the concrete as my body armor bursts forward. Several people notice my skin spontaneously bursting into a web of tree branches, bark, and roots. The exposure of the empowered is knocked out of the park today. If you're gonna go down, you might as well go down in a fiery ball of flame. Feline finesse. I leap up the 4 feet to land on the stage. Bestial strength. I cartwheel in the air and land with my hands up and ready to defend. Where's Bruin? He was here a minute ago. Yikers. He's supposed to be my backup. It's the work of a thought to call Berga to my hand, and I'm as prepared as I can be to defend against two vampires. The two of them engage, their fingers tipped with claws, their eyes as blood red and creepy as any horror flick villain. Spinning Berga, I'm able to keep them at a distance, but it won't work long. Bruin, a little help here. The roar of my bear in the distance is comforting. The roar of two lions in the crowd is not. Garnet tips his head back and lets loose a lung-vibrating roar. He's more pissed than homicidal, but the humans around him don't realize that because they don't know him. Another wave of panic washes through the crowd and ratchets up the insanity. In hindsight, maybe I should have assessed the danger before calling them in and adding more empowered fuel to the proverbial fire. Oops. People dive to the side like tipping dominoes as my bear races to my aid. We've fought in enough battles now that I'm not worried about hitting him with Berga as I dance my dance with the vampires. If I were trying to dispatch them, that would be different. I'm not. They're Xavier's family and are under a magical thrall. I'm not going to lop off their heads as a quick fix to a bad situation. I can't believe Eva did that. How do I fix that? Bruin rears up on his hind legs and towers over me. He's brutally beautiful when he's riled up, and I couldn't be prouder. He's as badass as they come. The posturing stops our vampire attackers in their tracks. They freeze, blinking at us as if they're rethinking their decision to come at me.
Lady Druid?
Marcus says, scanning the stage.
What's happening? Why? What have we done?
Laurent stands down too, and his eyes return to a normal, warm brown.
I don't understand.
Give me 1 second and I'll explain. Before I do that, I pull out my phone and scroll through the team trouble contacts. Finding the one I desperately need, I connect the call. Dan the Djinn picks up on the second ring. Hello? Hey, Dan, it's Fiona. We have a massive FUBAR situation at the Markham Fair in the Grandstand Stadium. We need your mind-washing superpowers. Come to think of it, bring everyone you can. Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're our only hope.
Well, that was one hell of a clusterfuck.
Garnet storms into his office, pulling off his ruined silk shirt. He grabs a clean one from the hanger on the back of his door and stalks back out to glare at us while he does up the buttons.
Would someone like to tell me what the fuck just happened?
Emmett holds up a glass box Dionysus devised to secure the dozen white bags he and Ciara removed from the roof of the concert center. These were tied all over the maze of scaffolding above the assigned seating. We think they're hex bags, but won't know for sure until a witch or a wizard can take a closer look at them.
Since I have to speak to Markdale anyway about the man you beheaded, I'll have him weigh in. Speaking of which, how did one of the West Village wizards end up in two pieces?
I was protecting Dylan, Eva grins. I have been charged to act as the guardian for the Cool family. We made every effort to de-escalate the wizards, as Fee suggested, but when his attack on Dylan drew him too close to death for my liking, I took steps.
It was less about steps and more about a swing, from the reports.
Eva smiles. I was within my purview as a guardian angel protecting my charge. Feel free to take it up with my supervisor, if you wish.
Which is who, exactly?
That would be Death. Garnet growls and turns his attention back to Emmett's burden.
Whether or not they're hex bags, they'll carry a magical signature we should be able to track to a community, if not the exact perpetrator. Then we can figure out what their alignment is.
I'm guessing dark, I say. Garnet pegs me with a droll glare.
Someone run this down for me from the top.
When all eyes fall on me, I shrug and accept the talking stick. I explain everything I know, starting with the first pulse of energy and ending with Ciara and Emmett untying the bags and shutting down their effect.
But the damage had already happened,
Garnet says. Unfortunately, yes. Although, yay, Emmett and Ciara, you guys did a great job.
But we weren't able to get them down before all hell broke loose,
Emmett says. I wave that away. You guys shifted forms and saved the day.
It would have been way worse if you hadn't gotten those bags down and locked in Dionysus's magical cake keeper.
Ciara, I didn't know transfiguration was one of your skills.
Ciara shrugs.
You forget. I've been a druid my entire life. Taking a simple form like a wee monkey isn't such a fantastic feat.
Well, I think it was, and I'm glad you were both there to get the job done when we needed it. The growl of Garnet's lion is a long, low rumble that makes the hair on my arms stand on end.
The wizards won't be happy. They already hate Fee, and this isn't going to help. It would be best if you all keep to yourselves for a few days while I sort this out.
That works for us, I say. We're headed out of town by tomorrow noon anyway. Let me know if you need us. Otherwise, we're taking a long weekend on the Emerald Isle, and we'll be back midweek.
Perfect. Hopefully by the time you get back, the dust will have settled.
Yeah. Hopefully. Chapter 3.
I heard you played the starring role in another shit show yesterday. Garnet mentioned the djinns had to throw a 2-mile memory wipe to cover the entire fairgrounds and the surrounding area.
I don't fall for the distraction. Sparring with Merlin is very different than sparring with my brothers, or even fighting against opponents. Merlin might appear relaxed as he blocks Burga with his staff, but he's planning the offensive maneuver he'll use on me 5 steps from now. I've learned this the hard way. When I don't respond, he smiles.
Cat got your tongue, Lady Druid?
I throw myself to the side in an aerial to avoid getting penned into a situation where my back is up against a tree.
Just keeping my eyes on the prize, old man.
Old? Who are you calling old?
The guy who was around to see Mother Nature invent rocks. That gets a laugh out of him. Rude and inaccurate, if you're going to put anyone in that category, your finger should be pointing at Dionysus. I jump over his staff as he attempts to sweep my feet. Checking my periphery, I make sure he's not sending any strangle vines to tangle me up and tie me down. Fool me once and all that. When I'm sure my blind spots hold no hidden dangers, I seize the opportunity and make my offensive move. Reaching out with my connection, I fold the earth beneath his feet and rush in to keep him from bounding out of my trap. Except when I move in, a gale force wind hits me from behind, and he vaults over my head. With my forward momentum, there's nothing to do but navigate my landing so I can get out of the pit I created before he closes me in. Spotting my landing, I've already envisioned my next move. The moment my boots meet the earth, I command the soil to raise me up and out of the hole. A fireball hits me square in the back and knocks me face first into the grass. I lose Berga in my attempt to save my face, and curse as my staff is sucked across the forest floor and into my opponent's hand. Damn it! I push myself up to my knees and brush the dirt from my palms. You make it look so easy! I honestly thought I was a decent fighter until we started sparring with you. Merlin offers a sympathetic smile. Don't be disheartened, Fee. I have more than a millennium of battle, magic, and strategic experience over you. Your skills are developing very quickly for a new fighter. These things take time. I glance at where Dylan and Emmett are squaring off against Sloan. It still takes the two of them to best the skills he's amassed over a lifetime of growing up a druid, and he's even stronger now that we're training in the Don Valley River system. Time is something we don't have. Once the culling starts, we'll face gods and demons and a dozen other dark fey opponents who are stronger than us. If the balance of good and evil rests in our hands, we must be better than skilled. We have to be powerful fighters. Then honestly, there is work to do. Merlin steps over to where I'm still sitting on my knees and extends his hand to help me up. If it makes you feel any better, you and your brothers have a year's worth of experience and a decade's worth of proficiency. Druids work at building their connections and their craft over entire lifetimes. It's all very new to you. I regain my footing and try to calm my frustrations. I know. We get our asses kicked more often than not. If it weren't for you, Sloan, and Wallace patching us up all the time, we wouldn't have survived this long. Again, give yourself a break. You and your brothers came into this a year ago, less than that. Your brothers didn't even start until you got home last fall. I understand that. But if we're supposed to be heroes in our own lives, we need to be able to hold our own against powerful forces. The idea that my brothers are unprepared for the coming fight makes me sick. I can't lose anyone else. Then the answer is simple, Cookie. He tosses me Berga and steps back, striking a ready pose. We'll practice hard and leave everything on the forest floor. I'll even ask a few of my empowered friends to step in and play the part of our enemy opponents. In 2 months, destiny will be what it will be. All we can do is meet it with as much strength and skill as we can muster. What can I say to that? He's right. No matter how much I wish it were different, we're a year into our training as druids, and there's no way to be any further along than we are. I wish we knew for sure who we'd be coming up against. Merlin tilts his head to the side, his long, dark waves brushing his shoulders as he lifts his staff. We know a handful. We'll study the strengths and weaknesses of the opponents we know and anticipate the rest. Berga sings on the breeze as I spin her in my hands, ready to begin again. Yeah, we know a handful of our opponents. Melanippe is an immortal Amazon. Mingin is a banished hunter god, Dark Soul, that merged with Reardon McNiff, an experienced druid. The Barghest aren't particularly dangerous, but Drogon will be pissed about Dionysus sending him to Antarctica, and they're loyal to Reardon. Then we have dark wizards, and I'm sure some demons, and likely a trickster or two.
We need a bigger force, I say.
As your messenger said, Nin Nert Kakur Lahela.
There is strength in unity. Yeah, no shit, weird rocking chair lady. No shit. Merlin and I engage in another round of muscle-tearing, back-breaking melee training, and I take the beating until I think I'm going to drop. Okay, I surrender. My arms are going to fall off. I send Berga back to her resting place in my forearm tattoo and stagger over to grab my water bottle. My muscles feel like rubber, and it's surprisingly difficult to walk when your legs are jello. Flopping onto the grass, I sip my water and try not to look as wiped as I feel. Merlin scoops a towel off the pile and dabs his face. Ha! What a faker. He's obviously doing that for my benefit because he's neither sweating nor winded. You, Cassie, and the others are coming to the birthday party, aren't you?
Wouldn't miss it. Cassie and Saxa plan to teach the young ones some of the ancient fireside songs as their gift.
I've been thinking about that. I think the party is my gift to them, but is that enough? What do dragons really want?
Shiny things. They love all things that glitter and shine. That's why the Queen of Worms and Cassie both have a treasure hoard they protect. They love all the baubles, coins, amulets, and trinkets. Anything like that.
All the glittery things. Got it. My phone rings, and I log roll a few times to reach my jacket instead of trying to get up. Normally, I'd let it go to message, but by the ringtone, I know that it's Samuel or one of the other hunter gods, Aaron or Quan Shen. Hold that thought, Master Merlin. This could be important. I rummage through my jacket pocket to find my phone, accepting the call right before it goes to message. Sweat drips down the crack of my butt, and I wriggle in my yoga pants as I sit up. Samuel? Is that you? The line stays muffled at first, then the background noise clears, and a deep, Sam Elliott-esque baritone answers.
Fee, it's Aaron. Listen, Samuel wants me to let you know we're closing in on Melanippe and Mingin. We nearly caught them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.